Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We've got a bunch of announcements for us today. I know it's a good day to sleep in and rainy. I'm glad everybody's here. This would be a good day to take a nap. I'm just suggesting. Jesus took naps, so it's okay. It's biblical. But got a couple of announcements. It is time again for Crisis Care Kits. You might have seen one of these little things on the pew on the end. There were two or three on each end of every single pew. The shopping list for Crisis Care Kits. There's also more out on the bulletin board if you want to grab some. We're going to be collecting the items for them and the complete kits between now and district assembly. So this is your shopping list. Now, you have a couple of options. If you want to go and build a kit or two or 20 or whatever, that's totally fine. And we've already got the 2 gallon Ziplocs, so don't worry about that. If you want to do that and bring the stuff in, that's awesome. If you just want to buy some of the things, or maybe you have these things in your pantry already, maybe you've got a couple of bottles of shampoo that you think, you know what, these are brand new and I could just bring them in, or a couple of bars of soap or something like that, you can bring in the stuff. We're going to put them all together right after lunch on the 21st. That's our regular third week carry-in dinner. We're going to put them all together and assemble them and send them to district assembly. There's a number of crisis care kits that we have collected throughout the year from a couple of different churches and different places and things. So we're going to put them all together and then we'll take them to district assembly. So anyway, if you could help out, those crisis care kits, they go all over the world, wherever a crisis is. They've been used here in the United States. They have been used wherever the Nazarene Church is. The catch is we have to send exactly this list and nothing more and nothing less. Because some of the countries that we send this to, if it is not exactly as approved, then the whole load can get rejected by customs. So as much as we want to slip something extra in there, or some cash, or a picture, or a couple of extra things in there, that can cause the whole load to get messed up in customs, and we don't want to do that. So anyway, there's your shopping list if you want to. If you're not a shopping person and you don't want to go out and get stuff, but if you just wanted to write a check or put some cash in an envelope, if you will mark it, Crisis Care Kits, we'll have somebody go out and shop and get the things that we need to finish up the partial ones that we have. So if you want to do that, that's an option also. So anyway, we'll be collecting this stuff between now and July 21st when our next lunch is, so that gives us about 3 weeks, and then we will take them all to district assembly. When is district assembly? I'm glad you asked. Somebody asked, didn't they? Maybe it's just a voice in my head. When is district assembly? Okay, it is the Thursday after our next lunch. Now, if you can remember when lunch is, that's going to be on the 21st. So let's see, the Thursday after that's going to be 22, 23, 24, 25. Is that right? 25th of July, did I do that right? Thursday. So Thursday night, and there's schedules all over the church, but Thursday evening kicks off our annual district assembly. It's in Hutchinson, at the old Hutch First, now called Aspire Church. It's only about a half hour drive. Thursday night will be our district superintendent's first report, and then a welcome reception for Kendall and Denise, our district superintendent, and his wife. And then Saturday morning starts our missions convention. Friday morning starts with missions convention. Friday afternoon is district assembly. Friday late afternoon is youth. And then Friday evening is ordination of the ordinands. And then Saturday morning, there's a thing that we're calling Equip Day. And there's going to be a couple of different seminars and trainings and meetings. Equip Day is really, really designed for lay people of the church to come and to hear what other churches are doing, to get inspired, to get some ideas, maybe get some information. And so I really would like to encourage you to consider attending one or all of those. But Equip Day should be really good this year. I've got my list of things that I want to hear. I know there's going to be some things for missions. There's going to be some sessions for youth. There'll be some sessions for outreach. which is one of them that I'm hoping to go to. So, but that's at District Assembly, and you'll hear about that for the next 3 weeks, and there are schedules up all over the church. If you want to take one with you so you remember, that's totally fine. Which brings us to this week. This is a busy week. Tomorrow is Monday, July 1st, and tomorrow evening we have the Glendening family. You see their picture up there. 6:30, we're having a cookout with burgers and food. So the burgers and the buns are already provided. We've got a couple of sides. If you want to come and bring a side, that's awesome. If you just want to come and eat and listen to them, they will be speaking right after supper. Martin and Sezi have served in Croatia since 2019. You know, there's been a lot of stuff going on in that area of Europe. Especially in the last 5 or 6 years. So it'll be really, really interesting. If you want to read their biography, that's on the denomination website, Nazarene.org. But basically, he is the Nazarene Compassionate Ministries Coordinator for Central Europe, and he is also a CPA, so he works in finance for the field. And she is the Field Strategy Coordinator for that area of Europe. So they're going to bring their two boys, and you see their picture there. So 6:30 tomorrow, burgers. Come and eat and encourage them and pray with them. We will take a free will offering, but don't think that you have to bring a lot of money just to hear what our missionaries are doing. They just want to share their story and to get out what's happening there. And mostly they like to talk to people, and I know we're good at that. So but that's tomorrow at 6:30. Then, also this week, take Tuesday off. Okay, I might not see you Tuesday, I might. But Wednesday, come back. We have a giant party. We're going to start the party. Hey, you have a slide up there. Wednesday, 6 o'clock, we're going to start games for everybody, for kids and everybody. At 7 o'clock is going to be our annual community-wide cookout. So, again, we've got meat provided. It'll be cooked out on the grill. Bring some kind of a side, a bag of chips or a thing of something salad or some kind of a dessert or a something, a potato salad or a cold salad or whatever. Put something together, some mac and cheese, and then come and celebrate. So we're just going to be sitting around in back playing games and chatting. Bring a lawn chair and enjoy the evening, celebrating not only the summer, but also that we are one day away from Independence Day. So that'll be our community-wide cookout. And tying that in with our VBS theme, which was Start the Party. You see flashing on the screen the different themes for the different nights that we've been looking at for VBS, that Jesus and his love is the best reason to party. And so we can party, we can invite people. Jesus invites everybody. I'm trying to remember what the other ones are. Everyone is invited to the party. Celebrate the good news. You'd think I was paying attention. And Jesus is the life of the party. So, and then last week we talked about how you can be a party starter. You can bring people to the party with Jesus. So anyway, we're going to have a big party on Wednesday in the backyard. 6 o'clock, we're going to have bounce houses, snow cones, popcorn, cornhole, washers, yard games, whatever it is people bring. If you've got a yard game to bring, just bring it. Bring a lawn chair. Come have fun. There is no ending time. It'll end whenever everybody goes home. And that might be in an hour or three. It might be dark. It might be after people do fireworks. I don't know. You go home when you go home. If I get tired, I'll just lock the door and go home. So, but yeah, we'll have that. If it is as hot as it was this week, 100 degrees still at 7 p.m., we definitely will be sitting inside for a little bit. Hopefully we can go outside and enjoy. So don't let the heat scare you away. Or the rain, for that matter. I don't know if it's going to be hot, if it's going to rain, who knows. We live in Kansas. So I think that takes me to the end of this week's announcements. It's a big week, isn't it? And celebrating the independence of our country on July 4th. Just please be safe in whatever you do. Be smart, be safe. With that, I'm going to invite Brian and his team to come up. Greet somebody on the way up. Tell them you're glad you see them. You're glad they're here, even if you have to lie. glad you're here.
Thank you.
That's no lie.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you all here. Boy, we got a really big home here.
I've probably been dragging my feet again.
Yeah.
I do that sometimes when the Lord speaks to me. I drag my feet. I shouldn't.
I know. I do. I'm the same way.
Yeah, don't drag your feet when the Lord speaks. Just
right.
Jump in there and go.
Speaking of rain, awesome. The Lord's blessed us with rain, abundant rain. It almost feels like fall out there. It's like, oh, I hope I don't have to get the snow shovel out.
My garden is happy.
Yeah, so is mine. Because I've been reluctant in watering. But, birthdays and anniversaries. I'm going to just read the list. Keith Blosky is having a birthday on the 30th. Debbie Crops is having a birthday on the July 2nd. And Miss Judy is having a birthday on the 6th.
Awesome.
I think Judy's the only one here, isn't she? Yeah. Any more anniversaries or birthdays that I forgot? All right. Well, let's sing Happy Birthday to Judy.
Happy birthday to you.
Side, so let's all stand and praise the Lord this morning in song. We're going to get your blood and your heart pumping here. I feel good.
I do too.
Me too. Me too. And I feel good too. Amen.
as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning. There are a number of prayer requests on the screens to the side. People who have requested prayer in our community and our family. Some of those people, we rejoice in the victory that the Lord has brought them. We are so thankful to see B today. It's good to see you up and around. We're so thankful for the healing that has already come to Gary's body. We ask the Lord to continue to heal them. We're thankful for the healing that has come to Richard. And we ask the Lord to continue to strengthen him. We're thankful for our, new district superintendent, Kendall Franklin, as he travels around. Continue to keep him in your prayer. Our new district superintendent, Richard Spencer, continue to keep him in your prayers. It's just so great to know that as a community of believers that we are lifting up each other. Maybe you came today with a specific joy on your heart. Maybe you came today with a specific concern on your heart or a worry or a situation that's not quite resolved. But we bring all of them to the feet of Jesus at the same time. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you knowing that you loved us first. We come to you to say, I love you, Lord. We bring to you all of our past worries, all of our past illnesses and hurts, all of the things that have happened, all the things that we have heard, all the things we have done, we bring them to you. We surrender them to you. We surrender our presence to you. We give you our future, Lord, for the plans that are in the next week or the next month or the next year. Lord, knowing that you are in charge, that you know what your plan is. And so, Lord, we just ask that you would continue to partner with us, that you would reveal yourself to us. We thank you for the healing that you bring to our bodies. We thank you for the rain that you have brought, which heals our land, which nourishes the plants and the animals. Lord, we thank you for relief from the heat. Lord, we thank you for all of the changing seasons. As much as we like to grumble, it's amazing that you have put in motion this world that simply works and runs, that you change the seasons, the stars, the plants, the animals, that we all have seasons of growth and seasons of rest. Lord, that you have planned this. And everywhere that we look, we are amazed at your work. Lord, as we think about July 4th this week, first of all, Lord, we ask for safety for our people, for our nation, for those who represent our nation, for our servicemen and women. Lord, we ask that you would look on our nation, that you would heal the wounds, that we have deep wounds. We have hurt each other, Lord, that we have found new ways to hurt each other's feelings. And Lord, we ask that you would bring healing to our land, that you would bring consensus to our nation, that you would bring us together knowing that we are the United States of America. Lord, we ask that you would continue to be with our leaders. We lift them up, Lord, our national leaders, our state leaders, our local leaders. Lord, the people who lead in our jobs, in our communities, in our groups. Lord, you know that leading is not an easy task and that it's easy to get sidetracked into one way or another. But Lord, we ask that you would continue to guide our leaders, that you would continue to bless them with your vision, with your wisdom. Lord, we ask that you would look on our church, that you would fill us with your presence, that you would help us as we go out, that we would bring bursts of light like fireworks in the dark, that we would bring your presence everywhere that we go. Lord, we love you. We come here to worship you. Lord, we ask that you would look on our small worship, that you would honor us, that you would bless us with your presence and your leadership. And all of this, we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Let's continue to worship in song.
He is here. Hallelujah. He is here. Hallelujah. Holy, 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 hol
Offerings, these tithes, these gifts of love. We ask that you would multiply them for use in your kingdom, that you would bless those who give, that you would bless those who benefit, that you would bless those charged with administrating this for your kingdom, for your glory. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. I challenged us to live in the therefore, to live in the words of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 6, when he says, "Therefore I tell you, stop being worried or anxious, stop being uneasy or distracted about your life as to what you will eat or drink or your body or wear, but first and most importantly, seek after his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you." So I challenged us at the end of the message to live in the therefore, to live in the knowledge that we belong to Jesus, that we are his, that we are alive in Christ. And this week, I want to follow up with a question, or really a series of questions. What happens as Christ's people? What happens as the people of the Lord when we pray and we pray and we pray about something? And we pray and we pray and we pray some more. What happens if we get an answer? I know exactly. It gets quiet. Never thought about that. What happens if we get a direct answer? And what if we don't? Is that still an answer? And how do we know? The real question is, how are we going to react? How will we react if we get a real and direct answer exactly as we had hoped for? How will we react when something different happens? How will we react when we have not heard from the Lord, or we have not discerned or seen what He is doing yet? How will we react? Because we get to choose how we will react. Today's text, we see a couple of different very human reactions to answer to prayer. And so if you want to turn in your Bible, if you have your paper Bible, or digital Bible, or whichever version, if you want to turn to Acts chapter 12, 12th chapter of Acts, we're going to look at this miraculous story of God working and answering prayers in an amazing way. Today I'm reading out of the New Living Translation, but follow along in your favorite translation. So here is Acts chapter 12, starting in verse 1. About that time, King Herod Agrippa began to persecute some believers in the church. He had the apostle James, that's John's brother, killed with a sword. Okay, and that means he was beheaded. When Herod saw how much this pleased the Jewish people, he also arrested Peter. This took place during the Passover celebration. Then he imprisoned him, placing him under the guard of four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring Peter out for public trial after the Passover. But while Peter was in prison, the church prayed very earnestly for him. Verse 6 says, the night before Peter was to be placed on trial, he was asleep, fastened with two chains between two soldiers. Others stood guard at the prison gate. Suddenly there was a bright light in the cell, and an angel of the Lord stood before Peter. The angel struck him on the side to awaken him and said, quick, get up. And the chains fell off of his wrists. Then the angel told him, get dressed and put on your sandals, and he did. Now put on your coat and follow me, the angel ordered. So Peter left the cell, following the angel. But all the time, he thought it was a vision or a dream. He didn't realize it was actually happening. They passed the first and second guard posts and came to the iron gate leading to the city, and this opened for them all by itself. So they passed through and started walking down the street, and then the angel suddenly left him. Verse 11 says, Peter finally came to his senses. It's really true, he said. The Lord has sent his angel and saved me from Herod and from what the Jewish leaders had planned to do to me. When he realized this, he went to the home of Mary, the mother of John Mark, where many were gathered for prayer. He knocked at the door of the gate, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to open it. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed that instead of opening the door, she ran back inside and told everyone, Peter is standing at the door. You're out of your mind, they said, but when she insisted, they decided it must be his angel, or some translations say his spirit. Verse 16, meanwhile, Peter continued knocking. When they finally opened the door and saw him, they were amazed. But he motioned for them to quiet down and told them how the Lord had led him out of prison. Tell James and the other brothers what happened, he said. Then he went to another place. So, and I want to stop there. So there's two different guys mentioned in that same passage. Okay, we see in verse 2 that the apostle James, okay, John's brother, the son of Zebedee, was already beheaded. But then we see later on in verse 17, it says, go tell James. He didn't mean go tell the guy whose head was in a basket. There were several by that name, all of them good names, good fellows, you can tell just by their name. But anyway, the James he's talking about is James, the brother of the Lord. That James was the one who was basically the head administrator of that loose early church. He said, go and tell the guy who's running the whole thing. Go tell him about this stuff. Now we see several reactions to prayer in this, and I want to kind of look at some things in this today. Peter's first thought when told to get up, when it was struck on the side, can you imagine being asleep, you're in prison? tomorrow you're going to be brought to a fake trial or a trial, and pretty sure that you're going to be sentenced to death just like James was, because the people cheered and you know this is going to happen. And so you're finally getting a little bit of sleep, barely fall asleep. You're chained to two guards, and all of a sudden something whacks you in the side and says, "Hey, get up." "Man, I don't want to." "Get up." It's a bright light. Now, I mean, it makes sense to think that that was a dream, you know, a bright light, somebody smacks you and says, "Get up." Your handcuffs fall off. His first thought is, "Yep, I'm dreaming." Have you ever had one of those dreams where you knew it was a dream and you could enjoy it? I used to dream all the time when I was a kid that I could fly, kind of like a bird, that I could literally flap my arms and fly. And I would fly around the neighborhood and down the alley, and I'd see all the houses in the neighborhood where I grew up. And I knew it was time to wake up when I started running out of energy, and the harder I worked, the less I could fly, and I'd end up hitting the ground. And then I'd usually wake up and realize, oh, that was a fun dream. I'd go right back to sleep. But what I didn't realize until later on was, because I had a habit of sleeping on my arms, I would wake up and my arms would be numb. That's why I couldn't flap them anymore. I thought they were tired. But Peter finally comes to the conclusion that this was not a dream. Kind of shakes himself awake and decides he's going to go to this house, this Mary, the mother of John Mark, according to verse 12. Now, there's some things that we miss in our modern translation that original readers of this would understand. And first we have to remember that Luke, the author of the Gospel of Luke, this is his second book. Acts is the second part of Luke. So it's the same guy who starts out Luke by saying, I've studied this, I've researched it, and tried to put together all the details. Dr. Luke, he's trying to put all this stuff together for them, okay? And so we see that the king, Herod, had imprisoned him, Peter. We see in verse 4 that he placed him under guard of four squads of four soldiers each. What we don't realize is that normally the most dangerous criminals, okay, the maximum security, would be chained to one guard and would have another guard standing at the gate. That was the most maximum security they had. Well, Herod is probably remembering last time Peter was arrested and he got out of prison. So he has him double guarded. He has him chained to two guards. And there is another two at the gate. And there's four sets of those. So quick math, 24 hours, four sets. They're working 6-hour shifts. Instead of the 10 to 12 hour shifts where people fall asleep, kind of like the guys who fell asleep who were guarding Jesus' tomb, right? They fell asleep. Okay, this is a problem. Now, when you fall asleep as a prison guard and they find out that you were asleep at your post, we know what happens. They kill you. So these guys, they've seen it happen. They've heard about it. They've heard about these darn followers of this guy named Jesus. They think that he really has been resurrected. They keep getting more and more followers. They think there's these miracles. And so these guys are concentrating on their job. I mean, two guys chained to Peter, two guys watching the gate. It makes sense that Peter would think he's dreaming. He's been double guarded. Doesn't work out that way. So he goes to this house, this large house. He's a couple of blocks out of prison. He's within a block or two of the house. And he knows this is where the people are gathered. He knows that's where they're going to go. That's apparently where they would go, to this big house, to this well-known house. It was a safe place. Remember, the believers, they were being persecuted. They were being arrested. They were being beheaded. Okay, so they would not just go to any old place. They'd go to a place that was safe. It had a big bolt on the door. And they were praying. This is the middle of the night. They're praying. Okay, now, I'll tell you that I do sometimes wake up in the middle of the night and pray. But honestly, I don't stay up all night every night praying for you. I go to sleep at night, just like you do. But the early church, they were convinced when something was really important that the people should gather together and pray, even if it's all night long. We do that sometimes, don't we? Maybe not enough. As I studied this, I thought, how often do we get together for earnest prayer, concentrated? Not very often. When we do, it's a very important event, right? Sometimes we hold a prayer vigil or something like that. Well, the early church was convinced they should do this when things are important tonight. So they were continuing to pray all night. They really did live, as James 5:16 says, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective, or as the New Living Translation puts it, I love this, the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. We know that. We know that prayer produces results. We know that prayer works. We know that. They knew that. Okay, now, sometimes we get caught up in that word righteous. That just means right standing with God. People who have been forgiven through Jesus Christ and declared righteous. It doesn't mean that it's the people that are perfect, the goody-goody people of the church. Those are often the people we want to pray for us, right? We want to call the people who are maybe in charge of the church board or something and say, okay, your prayer must be more than mine. Not necessarily. It says the prayer of a person who believes in Jesus. It is important. It's one version, the King James version that I memorized says, availeth much. I don't know what availeth means. I think it means it works. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing, because I do the same thing. When I have a big prayer request, I call my friends who are pastors. I call my friends who are prayer warriors. I call the board. I call my district superintendent. I call people that are across the country and say, hey, I got a big prayer request. Can you say a big prayer? Well, this is a big prayer. They're praying for Luke. They send the girl to the door. Her name is Rhoda. Rhoda means flower. So just like us, they were in the habit of naming their girls after pretty things. They named them Petunia and Rose and Pretty Flower and Daisy, just like we do. Okay? In that time, nobody named their girls Toewort or Stinky Feet or Big Nose. You know, that's not how we name girls. Now, those are names that guys call each other in a locker room. If you've never been in a guy's locker room, that's kind of how that works. The girls, they gave him a pretty name. So Rhoda, it says she was a servant, that she had an important job, that she was the one that went to the gate to see who was there. Now, that was a really important job, especially if you were being persecuted, especially if you thought that you might be arrested at any time. I don't know about you, but a knock on the door at 3 a.m. is either somebody lost, somebody important, or something happened that's wrong. Right? 3 o'clock in the morning, someone's pounding on the door and they won't go away. I'm thinking, uh-oh, you are either lost, it's very important, or something bad has happened. And so they send this girl. Now, the reason we know she is important, because she just wasn't any old servant. She has a name. She has a name that's recorded by Luke. Now, That always tells us that it's important that is a person who was respected and valued. Not only that, she's a believer. She was up praying with them. Everybody else was asleep. It's the middle of the night. And so, they have a knock at the door. They say, all right, dear, why don't you go and see who's at the door? We're going to continue to pray. Doors are locked up. It says that Peter knocked on the gate door, the outer door. So this house is big enough and safe enough to have a locked front door or porch door and a locked gate door that is secure. Otherwise, Peter would have just walked up and knocked on the door, right? But he has to knock on the gate. We also know from the text that she recognized Peter's voice. Now think about it. Who are the people that you recognize their voice? People you know, people you're close to, people you love, people you've been around, people that you recognize their voice on the other side of the door are people you've been around a lot. Now, here in the church on Sunday morning, I usually know when Don and Marilyn come in the far door because I recognize their voice. Usually I know most of us when we come in, I know, you know, everybody shows up in about the same order. You probably don't know that, do you? It's kind of funny that people show up generally in the same order, except today Brian and Stacy were a little bit early and they surprised me. You show up early and out of order, I have to really think, okay, I guess I do know your voice. I do know what you look like. I do know what your car is. But this girl, she recognized Peter through the door and immediately knew it was him. She was so excited because they had been praying hard. She was so excited that she didn't even unlock the door. She just ran to tell the other people. You know, you get, who is it? It's me, Peter. Peter! And then she runs away. And he's standing outside the door going, hello. Being chased by the guards. Hello, just broke out of prison. Hello, it's me, Peter. Hello, and she's in the other room saying, it's Peter, it's Peter, it's Peter. And everybody else says, oh, shut up, we're praying for Peter. Too busy. Their first reaction is, no way. We've been praying for Peter's release. We've been praying for a miracle. We've been praying for the Lord to act, for the Lord to show us. Maybe it's getting close enough to when they think he's going to be executed. They may have started turning their prayers to, we hope that he can be brave, that he can face death. We hope that he can keep the faith. We hope he can not embarrass himself. You know, we hope that the Lord will give him strength to face this. But we also pray that the Lord will release him. And she says, but he's standing out there. And here's Peter. It's me. It's me. Kind of funny. You ever been interrupted with news that your prayers have been answered or something big has happened? Can't talk right now. Don't talk to me. You ever been interrupted when somebody had something important to say and you weren't aware enough to know that I need to listen? I don't know if it's ever happened to you as a parent. Have you ever gotten someplace and one of your children is going, Dad, Mom, Dad, Mom? You're like, come on. You know, you're dragging them and you get someplace and they don't have shoes. I have. Our oldest daughter, we took a trip out of state and forgot to bring shoes. She was a toddler. We're kind of new at this parent thing, but yeah, we took a trip, we forgot to bring shoes. So we went and bought our shoes, don't worry. Let's see, where do we leave these guys? Peter's outside knocking. She's inside arguing with the people. Would you all stop praying for Peter? He's here. And they're saying, shush, we're praying for Peter. We don't have time for this stuff. You know, it kind of reminds me of the old joke. I don't know if you've heard this one about the three guys marooned on a desert island. They've been there a while, and they see a bottle kind of floating up, and they know how jokes go. They know it's going to be a genie bottle, and so they all run over, and they all start rubbing on it, and sure enough, a genie pops out. The genie says, well, usually, I grant three wishes. And they all go, uh-huh. Says, but I'm kind of lost in this because you all three are kind of holding it. You all three are kind of rubbing the lamp. Tell you what, I'll give each of you one wish. And they go, oh, that's fair. The first guy goes, ooh, I got it. I wish I was home. He's gone. You know this one? Second guy says, hey, me too. I wish I was home. The third guy looks around and says, gee, I'm lonely. I wish my friends were here. Yeah. How will we act? How will we react when we see God working? When we see an answer to our prayers? Because the thing is, this is not just a fun story, a good story, or a funny story, but this is an instructional episode. This is included in Luke's follow-up to his gospel for an important reason. There's some application there. And the first thing that I think it shows us, the very first thing, is that God sees us. He knows us in our trials. He knows what we're going through. We have people that are locked in a room. They're praying earnestly and hard for Peter. They're heartfelt prayers. They are concentrated. They're up all night. They've gathered everybody around. They've got the important people. They've got the help that are believers. They've got everybody in one good place. They're having a great prayer service. Peter is asleep. Now, I don't think Peter neglected to pray for himself, but you know, when you're chained to two guards, you've got two guards staring at you. Sometimes you get done praying for yourself and you fall asleep, and that's okay. You know, it's okay. Peter's thinking, I don't know, maybe he's thinking about the last time he was in jail and he got out free. Maybe he's thinking about James, who didn't get out free. I don't know what he's thinking. But he's got double guard. He knows he's in a mess. They know he's in a mess. And I guess their first prayer is, God, do you see what's going on here? Can we inform you what's happening here, Lord? Hey, over here, Lord, do you see this? Are you busy? What gives? Are you going to act? Are you not going to act? You know, they're in a mess. You know, we read years later in 1 Peter 3:12, a quote from Psalm 34:15 says, "The eyes of the Lord watch over those who do right. His ears are open to their cries for help." You know, prayer is talking to God, but so many times prayer is a cry for help, right? One of the things that God said through the burning bush to Moses is, "I have heard the cries of my people." Over and over we read in God's word that God sends message, and one of the first things he says is, I've been watching. I am aware. I have heard your cries for help. I'm on the job. I'm here, and I'm going to act right now. And how will we react to that? As they're praying, Lord, please send an angel to unchain Peter, to guide him out the doors, to open the doors without anybody touching them. Lord, please bring Peter into the street with no one noticing, with no guards chasing. Lord, please bring Peter safely to us right now. Lord, please bring Peter, have him knock on the door right now so we can bring him in here. Lord, please, please bring Peter to knock on the door. Would you stop knocking on the door? We're praying. God hears the prayers. You know, if we pick it up in verse 11, Peter says, he finally came to his senses and realized it's true. It's real. It happened. God sees us. God hears us. And he acts. He does stuff. And we notice that prayer is the turning point of the passage. We have this funny scene where the girl who knows Peter is at the door. She runs away. You know, she runs in and interrupts. Says, I was just talking to this guy, and it's Peter. And says, shush. She says, no, it's him, really, really. She will not be silenced. You ever had God work, God show up, and you say, oh, praise God. And someone will say, oh, that wasn't God. You say, yeah, it was. You want to fight about it? You ever notice an answer to God's prayer and you say, well, you can be skeptical if you want, but that does not change the fact that God has acted here, that God has been here. God answers prayers. It takes a lot of faith to not believe in God, you know? That's a sidetrack. It takes a lot of faith to think that this universe was accidentally put together. That it was accidentally, our planet was accidentally put exactly in the right place, the right distance from the sun to have hot and cool seasons. That everything accidentally spins and rotates around each other. And while it's spinning and rotating around each other and other stuff is rotating around, it takes a lot of faith to not believe that God set that in motion. It takes a lot of faith to say, okay, plants just grow because that's how they're programmed. People just grow because that's how they're programmed accidentally. We accidentally learned to grow this way. We accidentally exist in this way. The earth works accidentally in this way. It takes a lot of faith to not believe in God. You know what? I don't have enough faith to not believe in God. Because that many accidents don't happen. And sometimes we have to face the fact that our prayers have been answered. Sometimes in better ways than we had asked. Sometimes in different ways that we have asked. Sometimes in exactly the way that we have asked, but maybe through a method that we didn't even think about. But the people, they believed that God would answer their prayers. They believed so much that they would not give up. But they had one small thing they forgot to notice when their prayers were answered. They knew that they should pray at all times about all things. Paul would write later in 1 Timothy. He would write, "I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. Ask God to help them. Intercede on their behalf. Give thanks for them. Pray this way for kings and all who were in authority, so that we can live peacefully and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. This is good, and it pleases God our Savior, who wants everyone to be saved and to understand the truth." God sees us. God hears us. God answers our prayers. You know, at this very moment, God hears our prayers. God knows what we're about to face, what we're going into this week. God sees it. God knows about it. He hears our prayers, and He is already at work. Sometimes we have to open our eyes and see that God is at work. That doesn't mean we stop praying, but we have to be ready to accept an answer when it comes. We have to be ready to see an answer when it comes. We have to be ready to see God working when He shows up. Sometimes that's a knock on the door. Sometimes that's an unexpected person that goes and checks the gate and comes in and says, "You're not going to believe this." Yeah, you're right. You're not going to believe this. Our prayers have been answered. I don't have time for that. I got to pray. Sometimes we need to stop and thank God for answered prayers, unanswered prayers, partially answered prayers, differently answered prayers, prayers we haven't seen the answer to yet, but we know that He hears. We know that He answers. We know that He sees. And so we can relax, we can live in the therefore don't be worried, knowing that God sees us, that God hears us, that He will answer in His time. Before we leave today, I want to pray a blessing over it. Pray with me. Lord, help us to see Your work. Help us to be aware of Your work, that when You do answer our prayers, and we know that You do answer prayer, that we'll be able to see it, that we will be able to glorify You with our bodies, with our mouths, with the things that we say and do, our reactions. Lord, help us to not be blinded by the best solution we can figure out when we know that You have Your kingdom plans. Lord, help us to come alongside You in Your kingdom. Help us to understand where You are working in Your kingdom. Lord, help us to glorify You for all that You have done, all that You are doing, and all that You are about to do. Lord, help us this week to glorify You in our actions, in our reactions. Lord, we ask that You would be with us as we go out into Your kingdom, into our mission field, that we would bring glory to Your name. We ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thanks for coming. Thanks for being here. Hello, internet people. Thanks for watching. Hope to see you all next week. We have a special speaker next week. Doc's going to bring the message. I will be in Spokane visiting my daughter. So Doc is going to be preaching next week. It's going to be fantastic. I have never heard a single person that said Doc is not a good speaker. So I encourage you to come. Pray for Doc this week as he prepares a message, and for us as we travel. Have a great week.